The Daily is supported by Fidelity Wealth Management, providing perspective on a client's entire financial picture. Investment minimums apply. Fidelity Brokerage Services, LLC. Go deeper into the day's most pressing stories with New York Times journalists, trusted sources, and the people affected. The Daily, hosted by Michael Barbaro and distributed by American Public Media. APM produces and distributes programs that inform and inspire, entertain, and engage audiences everywhere.
The Daily is powered by the journalism of the New York Times and is distributed by APM, American Public Media. You can go deeper into the stories you hear on The Daily at nytimes.com/The Daily. That's it for The Daily. I'm Michael Barbaro. See you on
Donald Trump, the first president in the history of this country to be impeached twice. What does this mean for country and party? Also, a look at preparations in Washington, D.C. for Joe Biden's inauguration. And sea shanties become popular in these cooped-up times.
Soon may the weatherman come to bring us sugar and tea and rum.
Erg! Join us Saturday and Weekend Edition from NPR News.
Saturday mornings at 8 on 88.3 WLIW FM.
This week in This American Life, growing up black in Russia, Elena always dreamed about who she might marry if she came to America.
One day, da-da-da-da, he'll be tall and black, da-da-da-da. Whose song was that?
And then, visits America, which is less filled with princes than a person might think. It's this week. It's Saturday at noon on 88.3 WLIW-FM and WLIW.org/radio, Long Island's only NPR station.
Serving eastern Long Island and coastal Connecticut, this is 88.3 WLIW-FM and WLIW.org/radio in Southampton, New York, Long Island's only NPR station. Your source for news, music, and entertainment 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
Marketplace is supported by Edison Research, dedicated to quality consumer research and public opinion polling for corporations and organizations worldwide. Learn more at edisonresearch.com/marketplace.
Well, here we are, kind of at the tipping point between the Trump and Biden economies, huh? From American Public Media, this is Marketplace.
Marketplace is supported by Progressive Insurance, protecting your business with specialized coverages for your commercial vehicles. More at ProgressiveCommercial.com. And by Cabot Creamery, a farm family cooperative since 1919, crafting traditional cheddar cheese, offering comfort recipes and educational resources at CabotCheese.coop. And by Mimecast, a cloud email security and resilience companion for Microsoft 365, safeguarding your company against phishing and risks of ransomware. Mimecast.com, relentless protection, resilient world.
In Los Angeles, I'm Kai Rizdal. It is Friday today, the 15th day of January. Good as always to have you along, everybody, as it always is. President-elect Biden has made it tangible the last couple of days how the handling of this virus and thus this economy is going to change come Wednesday noon. Lots else going on this week, of course. We'll talk about that, too, in the next six or so minutes. Six and a half, I think, technically. Gina Smilek is at the New York Times. Jordan Holman is at Bloomberg. Hey, you two.
Hey, Kai.
Hi.
So, Gina, let me start with you. The vice president, the president-elect, rather, I guess that's what we call him now, came out last night with his coronavirus relief plan, $1.9 trillion. Folks have probably seen the headlines. The thing that jumped out to me was that he wants to extend a lot of these benefits, joblessness and all of that, until September, which on the one hand is great that it's going to last that long. And on the other hand, it's scary that he's now saying out loud it's going to have to last that long.
Right. I guess it's the good news, bad news economy.
Right.
But
right.
Yeah, no. So I think a lot of this plan was actually pretty concentrated on this idea that we haven't got this virus under control. A lot of the focus in the first 100 days of his presidency needs to be getting this virus under control. Like, it's sort of the first basics part of this plan. You know, he includes $20 billion in the plan to roll out a national vaccine program. A lot of public health measures, you know, many of the provisions of this plan are basically dealing with the reality that you have to put that public health response first.
Yeah, and Jordan, he leaned into the whole idea that, yes, this is going to cost a lot of money, $1.9 trillion. But if ever there was a time to do some deficit spending, this is the time. And doing nothing would, in essence, the president-elect said, cost us more.
Right. Yeah. Biden, he said, it's hard not to see that we're in this once in several generations economic crisis. And like Gina was saying, definitely you had to get control of the virus. But what it's wreaked havoc on is state and local governments. And so putting money towards those budget shortfalls really helps the whole economy and helps so many other businesses that fall within that. So he's really just saying we have to spend a lot now just to get everything under control so it can start running again like it should.
The crazy part, though, Gina, on state and local, just to go sideways a little bit, is how uneven that hit has been across the country, right? Like here in California, we're going to have a budget surplus, right? Which 6 months ago, nobody would have said.
Yeah, it's been super interesting to watch because we saw revenues just not fall nearly as much in most places as expected. But in the places where it has fallen, it's been a pretty significant hit. And I think possibly the most important thing to keep in mind with state and local is even as we've seen a lot of states not come through this with a terrible revenue experience that we were expecting, we have seen expenses increase. And we've also seen states anticipate lower revenues in years to come. And so what we've seen is they're really reducing payroll even as some of the worst eventualities haven't come to pass. And I think that's the thing to watch and the thing to be worried about because state and localities employ like 13% of the American workforce. Yep. So if for any reason that continues, if for any reason those job cuts become permanent, I think you really worry about what that does to the labor market.
Well, Jordan, let's take it the next step, right? Because the labor market in this economy are consumers. Consumers, of course, in this economy are the whole shoot and match. And we learned this morning from the Commerce Department that retail sales were down in December. But you've been doing some other reporting, like from the National Retail Federation, which says, man, maybe not so bad.
Yeah, the National Retail Federation came out with their holiday sales showing that it increased by 8.3% during the holiday shopping season, so November and December. And honestly, that was a huge surprise to me when I saw that paired against the commerce data. But so let me break it down a bit.
Yeah.
It really just shows that despite everything going against consumers, the virus, you know, state restrictions, a lot of uncertainty, Americans are still going to open up their wallets. And they're going to spend online, which the retail sector has pushed so many of us to spend online. And that's where all of that, like 8.3%, is really bolstered by online sales. There was one stat that showed that online sales the past few months have led to the biggest year-over-year holiday increase this century. So that shows how important online it is.
The catch, of course, Jordan, is that we're still buying stuff, right? We're buying goods, not services.
Right. And so that's what you're seeing in the commerce data, because they're also looking at the broader retail economy. So thinking about restaurants, which can't leverage online like apparel shops can.
Right. Okay. Can't let a Friday go by in a week in this economy, Gina Smilek, without talking about Jay Powell. He did a sort of a set of remarks, did a Q&A thing at Princeton, in which he said, in essence, now is not the time for us to cut back on anything we are doing. The president of the Boston Fed, Eric Rosengren, said yesterday or this morning he believes $1.9 trillion is appropriate. The Fed is staying the course. They're all in.
Yeah, Jay Powell wanted us all to know how he really feels, which is that they are not thinking about raising rates, as he often says. Yeah. You know, I think it was interesting because there have been a couple of regional presidents out saying things that the market was interpreting as a little bit hawkish. And folks had started to kind of whisper about, you know, whether we were going to see rate hikes a little bit earlier than expected, or more importantly, and I think more pressingly, whether we were going to see a pullback in massive bond purchases. And Jay Powell came out and said, absolutely not. We are not talking about that. When we are going to talk about that, we will tell you. We will like broadcast that we are beginning to have that conversation, and we are nowhere near there yet. So, you know, patience remains.
It's just so interesting how clear he is trying to be, right, Gina?
Yeah, pretty unambiguous.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, so let me now, Jordan. I'm going to get each of you on a subjective question, and it kind of goes like this. And I do it from time to time. Haven't done it in a while. What's your gut telling you about the next 6 to 8 months in this economy, Jordan? You go first.
This is a good question. I think what it's telling me is once we get out the door with these direct stimulus to consumers, that will really start putting into place what we were seeing in early 2020 and getting back to, you know, 2019 levels, that people will start feeling really confident to spend. But everything kind of has to work as it should. Yeah. So we have to get the virus under control, and we have to put into place that people will feel comfortable spending. And if so, things could work out.
That's pretty optimistic. Gina Smilek, you get the last word.
I think that this is such an uncertain economy over the next 6 to 8 months. And what I mean by that is I can make a really compelling case for why we're going to see a roaring 20s boom over the next 6 to 8 months as all these folks who have tons of savings get to spending them, and we have fiscal stimulus hitting and interest rates are low and all these good things are happening. I can also make a case that vaccines don't roll out fast enough. The virus remains a sort of lingering problem, and the global backdrop is really negative. And so you don't see that at all. And so I think I could tell a compelling case that is like, this is not a good economy, or this is a gangbusters economy. And I don't have high confidence in either of those outcomes.
Oh, man. Okay. Well, I guess we'll leave it in suspense then at the end of a Friday afternoon. Gina Smilek at the New York Times, Jordan Holman at Bloomberg. Thanks, you too.
Thanks, Kai.
Thanks.
Have a great weekend. Wall Street to end the week. Well, they chose option B there from Ms. Smilek. Kind of deflated traders were. We'll have the details when we do the numbers. All right, so here's one from the optimistic scenario Gina painted. Some of the biggest banks in the country finished 2020 doing quite well, thank you very much. Profits at JP Morgan Chase jumped 42% compared to a year ago, that is, before the pandemic. Wells Fargo, Citigroup, and PNC Financial did fine, too. So we asked Marketplace's Justin Ho to read the economic tea leaves for what that might mean for 20 and 21.
Banks have two big reasons to be upbeat about the economy, says Kent Belasco, who runs the commercial banking program at Marquette University.
With the vaccine going on, with stimulus, it is an optimistic outlook at this stage.
JP Morgan Chase says between the vaccine and the latest round of relief payments, the bank can set aside less money to cover bad loans. Gerard Cassidy at RBC Capital Markets says there's still a risk that many borrowers will default, but
the credit losses are not coming in at the levels that were expected. And so now the banks are bringing some of that money back into earnings.
But the big reason why profits are strong is because banks are raking in fee revenue from underwriting IPOs, helping companies issue bonds, and executing stock trades for their customers.
If these trends continue, that will lead to some very strong numbers in investment banking and trading for not only the first quarter of 2021, but throughout the year.
While a booming stock market is helpful for the big banks, it's not as helpful for the overall economy, says Karen Petru at Federal Financial Analytics.
This is another example of the huge divide between how great the markets are doing and how poorly pretty much everybody else is doing.
This week, a group of economists with the American Bankers Association said economic growth isn't expected to pick up until the second quarter at the earliest. I'm Justin Ho for Marketplace.
A story now that is going to take us back a little bit more than 12 years to the middle-ish days of the financial crisis when things were, well, they were kind of falling apart. And the Bush administration put Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac into government conservatorship. That was, and it still is, a big deal because those two companies back basically half of all the mortgages in this economy. Both the Obama administration and President Trump said they wanted to get the government out of that equation and return Fannie and Freddie to private ownership. But they are saying that no more. In a statement late yesterday, federal regulators said they will let the companies hold on to more of their profits, but will leave their current structure pretty much intact. Marketplace's Amy Scott explains what that might mean for the $11 trillion mortgage market in this economy.
It's hard to overstate the importance of Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac to the mortgage market. David Stevens is with Mountain Lake Consulting.
These are two institutions that between the two of them hold about $6.6 trillion in obligations behind the mortgage-backed securities around the globe, the second largest currency next to the U.S. Treasury.
Which is partly why the Trump administration and the company's top regulator, Mark Calabria, wanted them back in private control. Kevin Erdman is a fellow with the Mercatus Center at George Mason University.
There's concerns, obviously, going back to the financial crisis that they represent a lot of taxpayer risk.
But the pandemic changed the equation, Erdman says. With millions of people unable to pay their mortgage bills and delinquencies on the rise, he says this is not the time to mess with the system.
If the worst case scenario somehow happened and there was this mass foreclosure event, it probably is best to sort of have that backstopped by the federal government.
Regulators will allow Fannie and Freddie to hold on to more of their profits. The goal is to eventually build enough capital to protect against losses that they could stand on their own. But Jim Parrott with the Urban Institute says the Biden administration is more likely to focus on how Fannie and Freddie can promote affordable housing and home ownership.
And that may eventually involve their release from conservatorship, but it may not.
And he says it certainly won't happen anytime soon. I'm Amy Scott for Marketplace.
Come Monday, if you need something to start your economic day, might I suggest David Brancaccio and the Marketplace Morning Report. Check it out. Coming up.
Even a pandemic's not going to keep me from going out and getting a vehicle.
You and a whole lot of other people, pal. But first, let's us do the numbers. The Dow Industrial is down 177 points today, about a half percent, 30,814. The NASDAQ tumbled 114 on the point scale, 0.8%, 12,998. The S&P 500 down 27, 0.7%, landed at 37.68. Justin was talking about banks releasing earnings. J.P. Morgan Chase beat profit, as we told you. CEO Jamie Dimon, though, said near-term economic uncertainty is a concern. Yes, it is. J.P. Morgan off 1.7% today. Citigroup down 6.9%. With banks in mind, Bankrate.com's recent survey of interest and fees on bank accounts for 2020 found that the average yields, remember that's an interest rate, average yields on interest-bearing checking accounts sank to 0.04% last year. Tied for a record low. You're listening to Marketplace.
Marketplace is supported by GEP. GEP helps businesses transform supply chains with strategy, managed services, and AI-based cloud-native software, including the GEP Smart Digital Procurement Platform and GEP Next, real-time supply chain visibility and management software. Learn more at GEP.com. And by Personal Capital, who can help with retirement plans or spot hidden fees with professional-grade financial tools. Learn more at personalcapital.com. There's no place like financial confidence. And by LifeLock, reminding consumers that they could miss certain threats by only monitoring their credit, like their info for sale on the dark web. Learn more at LifeLock.com/marketplace.
On the next How I Built This, we talked to a restaurateur who realized his destiny on the label of a can of chipotle peppers.
And I said, oh my God, that's the name. I'll call it Chipotle. So imagine choosing a name that people can't pronounce and they don't know what it means.
And on Planet Money, we meet a hacker in Taiwan who is bringing civic tech to Taiwan's coronavirus response. That's on the next Planet Money and How I Built This from NPR.
Saturday mornings at 6.
I'm Stephen Dubner. On the next Freakonomics Radio, how will a pandemic affect family formation in the U.S.?
We are expecting a pretty large baby bust.
And how much do we really think about kids when considering public policy?
I feel very strongly that kids get short shrift in our policy and political environment.
That's next time on Freakonomics Radio.
Saturday afternoon at 4 p.m. on 88.3 WLIW-FM.
I'm Kai Rizdahl. You're listening to 88.3 WLIW-FM and WLIW.org/radio, Long Island's only NPR station. This is Marketplace. I'm Kai Rizdahl. Ajit Pai, the chairman of the Federal Communications Commission, steps down next week, as is customary at the change of administrations. When we talked earlier today, Chairman Pai offered a list of things he is proud the agency has done during his tenure. Working to bridge the digital divide, he pointed out. Establishing 988 as a three-digit national suicide prevention hotline. And, which is why we wanted to talk to him on the way out, deregulation, a hallmark of the Trump administration. The defining deregulation of the FCC under Ajit Pai has been his decision to undo something called net neutrality. Earlier policies that had said internet service providers can't slow down some traffic on their networks in favor of other traffic. The market, Pai believes, should decide. Light regulation, he calls it, and he thinks it's worked out pretty well.
It has been an enormous success. If you look at the facts, as opposed to the headlines that were there at the time, and or including when you and I talked in June of 2018, we now see that fiber deployments in the United States set a record in 2018 and 2019. And remarkably, the internet remains free and open, that people are able to access content of their choice, and startups are able to innovate on this platform. So notwithstanding the headlines back then, as you might remember, we finished our interview back then by saying, look, let's look at the evidence in a few years. The evidence is positive.
Right. That's why I asked, right? Because there are certainly some moves that net neutrality has brought that the FCC has reason to be proud of. But let me ask you this. To the root of our conversation 2 years ago and to the next several minutes of this interview, the internet is even more now than it was 2 years ago, right? Because the kids are going to school and everybody's working from home. We all need it as we need electricity and plumbing. Why should it not be regulated as such?
So I do believe that the debate is no longer a debate over whether internet access is a luxury or a necessity. It's a necessity. To me, it's clear that the utility-style regulation that would be imposed under net neutrality does not serve the consumer at the end of the day. Perhaps the best evidence comes from abroad. In Europe, which has these utility-style regulations, treats the internet like the water company or the electric company, regulators had to go hat in hand to companies like Netflix and YouTube at the beginning of the pandemic and ask them to proactively throttle content to consumers because they had not had the infrastructure investment needed to keep up. Moreover, there are parts of the digital divide in Europe that are not getting addressed because there's simply not an incentive to build those networks.
So let's talk about private companies here and some of the power they have in this economy. And I need to turn the page to Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act, which is, in the waning days of your chairmanship, has become the net neutrality of 2020 and 2021, right? The provision of the law that gives immunity for social media companies and many others for what people say on that site. Do you think, I'm just going to go straight for the 800-pound gorillas first, do you think Twitter and Facebook have too much power?
I do think that those companies, among others in the social media space, do not operate by the same principles that other companies in the internet economy do. For example, with respect to Twitter, who makes the decisions about content moderation? Why is one actor not allowed to post, but the supreme leader of Iran is? These are the types of things that, with respect to internet service providers, the FCC has instituted regulations. And I think that's part of the reason why in the halls of Congress, there's a growing bipartisan consensus that we need to reexamine the regulatory framework for these companies. Now, the FCC doesn't have authority here. That's a decision for Congress and the next administration to make. But I do think that there are growing questions about transparency and consistency.
If the FCC doesn't have authority here, why did you say a number of months ago you were going to take a look at a new rule to figure out how to implement 230 at, one might reasonably assume, the behest of the President of the United States, who has not been shy about his feelings about this law?
Well, we don't have authority to change the law, which is what many elected officials are talking about. With respect to the Section 230 announcement I made, the Department of Commerce submitted a petition to us, and we made an independent determination that we had legal authority to interpret that immunity provision, and that narrow provision only. That's one of the things that we were considering, and we decided that there wasn't time to move forward. But I do think this is an issue that's going to grow as the social media increasingly becomes the public square when it comes to political discourse.
We'll just pause to note children screaming in the background and random thuds because we're all making radio from our living rooms.
Sorry about that.
No, look, it's the way it is. It's the way it is. Let me actually just pick up on what you just said and ask you sort of the follow-on question, right? Because in a matter of 6 or 7 days or whatever it is, you will no longer be the chairman of the FCC. There will be somebody else who will be a Democrat, approved by the Democratic Senate now. And I wonder about this idea that you and I talked about last time, regulatory ping pong. Because net neutrality is going to come back up. Section 230 is going to come up, and whoever chairs the FCC is probably going to have an opposite point of view as to you. What is the role of Congress in these decisions? And I guess why do our regulatory agencies have to do this kind of ping pong?
Congress needs to put on the page exactly what the rules should be so that administrative agencies don't swing back and forth depending on the political affiliation of its leader. Now, you mentioned net neutrality. That, I think, is an actual relatively simple fix. No blocking, no throttling, no anti-competitive yeah. conduct.
Sorry, I can't help but laugh when you say it's a simple fix. I mean, come on.
Oh, it is. No, I think it is in terms of the substance. Now, the politics, of course, are much more difficult. But even beyond that, for example, my first major speech as chairman, I urged Congress to think about infrastructure legislation. This is back in 2017, yeah. allocating $50 or even $60 billion for broadband. And if they had done that in a bipartisan way back then, think about how much better off we'd be today. And so I think that it's important for Congress to update the rules, to tell the American people, you've elected us to make this judgment about the digital economy. Here is our judgment. And then agencies have a little more certainty, and so would consumers at the end of the day.
Ajit Pai, the outgoing chairman of the Federal Communications Commission. Mr. Chairman, thanks for your time, sir. I do appreciate it.
Thank you for having me.
Edmunds, the car people, were out with some numbers the other day. New car and truck sales were down 15% last year, they said. Not surprising, given all the economic shutdowns, that huge jump in unemployment last spring, and the general economic agita that has lasted pretty much all year long. But the average price of the new vehicles that did sell was, in the fourth quarter, $40,000, the highest ever, and as Marketplace's Erica Barris reports, one more sign, as if we needed it, that there are a couple of different realities going on in this economy.
For a lot of people, their 2020 finances were okay. They were gainfully employed and got stimulus money. For many others, 2020 was an exercise in financial hardship. And that means, according to Mike Ramsey, an analyst at Gartner, a research group, people who would have bought a less expensive new vehicle didn't.
So the average price, transaction prices moved up because the vehicles that continued to sell were selling to people who were buying more expensive vehicles.
So people priced out of new vehicles turned to used ones. Those sales were down from the year before, but still higher than expected in 2020. So were the prices of those vehicles, says Kristen Gicek with the Center for Automotive Research.
So we really saw skyrocketing prices in the used car market.
G-Check says part of that was also supply and demand. When manufacturing halted, there weren't that many new vehicles out there, driving shoppers to look at used ones. But those two, not necessarily a bargain. Because as Edmunds analyst Jessica Caldwell says, these days, used cars tend to not be cars.
More expensive trucks, SUVs, a lot of electrified vehicles, and that is bringing up prices.
Even with low interest rates, buying vehicles can turn into long-term debt for people. That was already a growing problem before the pandemic. And the CARES Act didn't include any auto loan relief.
Taking on debt for personal transportation is a real challenge for American families.
That's Charlie Chesbro, an analyst with Cox Automotive.
If I need personal transportation, I need to get to my doctor's appointments or my job. Even a pandemic's not going to keep me from going out and getting a vehicle.
And he says that's something we saw in 2020. I'm Erica Barris for Marketplace.
This final note on the way out today comes from the National Rifle Association in the form of this announcement. Quote, today the NRA announced a restructuring plan that positions us for the long term. It goes on after that, of course, but the upshot is that the NRA, after years of financial mismanagement that burst into the open the past year, maybe 18 months or so, the NRA is seeking protection from its creditors under Chapter 11 of the Bankruptcy Code. It's got assets, according to the filing, of about $500 million, debts of about the same amount. It's also going to move to Texas from New York and try to regroup there.
Marketplace is supported by C3.ai. C3.ai software enables organizations to use artificial intelligence at enterprise scale, solving previously unsolvable business problems. Learn more at C3.ai. And by Staples, with supplies to get business done, from ink and toner cartridges to technology like webcams and networking accessories. More at Staples stores or staples.com. And by Noom, a personalized program based in psychology to help people understand their motivations, change their habits, and lead healthier lives. Learn more at Noom, Noom.com.
All right, we got to go, but not without your end-of-the-week moment of economic context. Hat tip to Chad Bown at the Peterson Institute. He does trade over there, tracks all this stuff really closely. Today is the one-year anniversary of President Trump signing that Phase 1 deal with China. Remember that? It was supposed to be the beginning of the end of the trade war. So far, China has bought just about half of what they had promised to buy under that deal. And, oh, by the way, we're still putting tariffs on hundreds of billions of dollars worth of Chinese imports. Our theme music was composed by, come on, anybody? Yes, BJ Lederman. Marketplace's executive producer is, yes, Nancy Farnelli. Nancy Cassett is the managing director of news. I don't know what I'm doing. I'm Kai Rizdahl. We will see you Monday, everybody. Have yourselves a great weekend, all right? This is AP.